lift up out of those 15 verses, verse number 12, where it says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he have chosen for his own inheritance. I want to preach by the aid of the Holy Spirit for just a few moments in your hearing. A sermon simply entitled, If Our Nation Is to Be Blessed. If Our Nation Is to Be Blessed. Let us pray. Father, it's preaching time and as always I need you. I'm here. People are here. We recognize your Holy Spirit is here to illuminate our eyes that we may see, to open our ears that we may hear, and Lord, to place your word in our hearts so that we may not sin against you. We need you. Can't do it without you, but with you, all things are possible. This is our humble prayer, and it is in Jesus' name. And as God's children, we say, Amen. May be seated in the presence of an Almighty God. If our nation is to be blessed. My brothers and sisters, I think that most of us would agree that our nation has indeed been blessed. We have been blessed materially. We've been blessed geographically. We have indeed been blessed educationally as well as technologically. As we celebrate the birth of our nation this month, we need to make sure that we understand that surely God has blessed us real good. Can I get a witness in here? Even this Sunday, as troops are still winding down in Afghanistan, we are reminded that it's a heavy cost to pay for the freedom that we enjoy. Even when you take the time to look at the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence, 5 of them were captured and tortured by the British before they died. 12 had lost their homes and were ramshacked and burned down to the ground. 2 lost their sons in the war. 1 had 2 sons captured. And 9 fought and died from wounds or hardships of war. The list goes on, and time would fail me to be able to tell about those who had ships, and because the British came in and knocked all of their ships out of commission, and one of them, Thomas Nelson, even died poor because of the result of just that. But scripture is not silent about our nation. We learn that God is greater than all nations. All right. Can I get a witness?
Amen.
We also learn that nations come and nations go. We learn that God has a plan for the nation, and that people from all nations will be a part of his kingdom that truly love the Lord. But perhaps as we move forward, we have to remember something about this independence that we have. Our greatest danger is not an external danger, something coming from outside like terrorism, as bad as terrorism is. But the danger that we face is an internal danger. For if a nation forgets about the God who allowed it to come to be in the first place, we can find ourselves in a world of trouble. God's word teaches us specifically what a nation is to do in order to receive and continue continue in the blessings of God. If our nation is to be blessed, the Bible lays it out a lot in Psalms 33, verses 1 through 15. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. If the nation is to be blessed, we've got to, number one, acknowledge and worship the living and true God. It's possible to get so caught up in what's going on in society that we can try to put false gods before the God that we are supposed to worship and serve. Y'all gonna pray with me today? False God of material wealth. Some people measure how blessed they are by how much money they have. And some people measure, on the flip side, how blessed they would be if they had a lot of money. But the God of material wealth is a poor God. For what is it to gain the whole world and to lose your own soul? There is another God, worldly pleasures, and all you have to do is just simply go to commercials and you can see the worldly pleasures are all over the place. You can't sell a car without a young woman on there, half scantily dressed. Some people can't move forward because they're always looking for somebody in the world to approve what they're doing. And worldly approval is a dangerous place to be. The one that we want to make sure we please is the one who sits high and looks low and is a very present help in a time of need. But there's another God that you got to be careful about, and that's the God of physical appearance. It's all right to work out. It's all right to try to stay in shape. There's nothing wrong with that. But when you get to the place that you worship your body, where you got to have it just right all the time, you're getting to the place that you can worship physical appearance. And some may say, well, there's not that much going on. I made the difference. There are folks that are running back and forth to doctors, nipping and tucking and amen, somebody. Make your lips bigger, make your lips thinner. Make your, will you get the idea? Amen. People are worshiping physical appearance. But not only that, you have folks that are hungry for power and influence. Sometimes it shows up in the church more than it shows up anywhere else. Wow. Folks can't run things on their job, so they come into church and want to run things. Wow. Folks can't run things in the house. Amen, somebody. They want to come into church and run things. And if it don't run the way I want it to run, amen, like some water. Not only do we need the number one acknowledge and worship the living and true God and leave all those false gods alone. If our nation is to be great, is to be blessed. Secondly, verse 4 and 6 points out of people who seek to know and do the word of God that calls them to do whatever it is he wants them to do. You got to make sure that you stay focused and be about the Father's business. You got to be in agreement with the songwriter when he wrote, a charge to keep I have, a God to glorify, a never dying soul to save and fill it for the sky. We got to realize that we need to serve this present age. Have I got a witness in the house? If brothers and sisters, if we want our nation to be blessed, we must acknowledge and worship the living and true God. Yes, we must seek to do God's will and God's work. Yes. It's so possible to get so caught up till God is not even on the list of where he can pencil me. Can I get a witness in here? Yes. I remember I used to be so busy till I had two jobs and I was working and running all over the place and I was running and sororities and had time and money for all of that, but didn't have time for God. It's possible to get too busy on earth for God. So we got to make sure that we seek God and do what He wants us to do. But thirdly, we must be a people who fear and show reverence to God. There's too many folk nowadays that don't even show reverence to God. Talk about God any kind of way. Use His name in all kind of ways. We've got to have reverence for God. We've got to have fear for God, because Proverbs, the first chapter, verse 7 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. Brothers and sisters, when you get to the place that can't nobody tell you nothing, when you get to the place that the word of God is not important to you, you say, how, what you talking about, Reverend? When you can take it or leave it when it comes to church. When you can come when you want to, leave when you get ready, and don't feel nothing about missing the word of God. Can I get a witness in this place? You got to watch it, because the devil has a trap for you when we get to the place that we don't fear God. We got to make sure that when it comes down to God, we respect Him and we honor Him. And we look to adhere to what God wants us to do. But at least I keep you too long. We've got to make up our mind. If I had time, I would go on down through verse 10 and 11 where it talks about a people who seek the Lord's plan, not their own. In other words, you got to get to the place where it's not my will, but thy will be done. So many times in this life, we get to the place as a nation that we put everything above God. But we got to get back to the place that for God I live and for God I die. If I had time, I would go on verses 13 through 15, where it speaks about a people who know that they are accountable to the Lord. He watches them and considers everything they do. You see, you got to realize that the Lord knows that we're human beings down here. But that's no excuse for us just to run amok and act any old kind of way. We got to respect the God that we serve. And we got to come to Him with all of our frailties. And we got to still lift up the name of Jesus. Am I right about it? You got to understand, if our nation is to be blessed, the future blessings of America, we got to realize that we got to live for Christ. It's time out for having time for everything but God. We got to make time for the one that we say that we serve. Am I right about it? We gotta realize that we are the salt and the light of the earth. We gotta realize it, because no matter where you go, you gotta realize that when you go in, they may be acting one way, but because you came in, God gives you the ability to be light and a dark. Somebody in here right now, go into a dark place every time you step in the door of your job. But you got a chance to walk in there and the folks see the light in the midst of the darkness. Have I got a witness in here? It ought to, after a while, by and by, begin to change. You may go in there and they cussing up a storm. Not you necessarily, but the God on the inside of you. Am I right about it? Say it. If we want to see this nation blessed, it's got to start with us. We got to be the salt of the world. How do you be the salt? What does salt do? It makes you thirsty. And we ought to give them a drink of water. Am I right about it? Say yeah. But the main thing we gotta do. want to see the nation change?
Yes, sir.
Let the Lord change you.
Yes,
then go into a world that hasn't been changed and become the change agent. Go in and watch folk begin to change. How do you know he can do it? Somebody can bear witness that he did it for you. Remember where you were? Hello, somebody. I know how to call the roll. Just look back over your life and think things over. You got a testimony, don't you? Amen, somebody. Let the Lord use us to change the nation. Somebody said, Reverend, there were so many of us, I've seen him take 12. And one of them was a devil. And he took the rest and it multiplied. It added where it needed to add. It subtracted where it needed to subtract. It divided where it needed to divide. 12. One ran off and committed suicide. Next thing you know, it was 120 in another room. They came down, speaking in tongues. Next thing you know, the church was added 3,000 in one day. One day can make a big difference, y'all. If you just be about the Father's business. All I can do is prepare a sermon and give you what the Lord gives me. If you take it out there, it'll spread like wildfire. Next thing you know, souls will be saved. And lives will be changed. That'll change our nation. Amen?
Amen.
Let us stand. That'll help our nation to be blessed. There could be someone here that does not know Jesus Christ and be part of the mission. If that's you, the doors of the church are open. Now is the time to come. Now is the time. If you don't know it, let me make it plain. Hell is going to be your home. And Jesus came and died so that none of us would have to go to hell. But in order to go to heaven, you have to accept him as your personal Lord and Savior. Believe that he died for your sins and God raised him from the dead and he lives now and forevermore. And ask him to come in your heart. He'll be your Savior. Then, when your eyelid go down and come back up and you've left this life and going on to be with him, to be absent from the body will be present with the Lord. If you don't know it, now is the time to come. Is there one? Is there one? Is there one that wants to come and to give your life to Christ? There could be someone looking for a church home. God has led you here. Now is the time to come. You can come by letter. You can come by Christian experience. You can come as a candidate for baptism. However you come, now is the time. Won't you come? Won't you come? Let us bow our heads. Father, we thank you for first allowing us to be born again. Then, Father, we thank you for allowing us to live in this great nation. I hear so many talk about it. I see people trying to get here, but I don't see too many trying to get out of here. So, Lord, help us to love this country. Help us, Lord, to pray for our leaders that they will do what's best for you and the country and our surrounding neighbors. Help us, Lord, to be about the Father's business as we leave this place. Then, Father, we pray that you will just continue to lead us, guide us, show us what to do and what not to do. We need you, Lord. We can't do this work without you. But with you, blinded eyes can be opened, and deaf ears can be unstopped. The lame can walk, and we appreciate all that you have done for us in the past, all that you're doing for us right now, and all that you're going to do. This, oh God, is our humble prayer. And it is in Jesus' name that we do pray. And as God's children, we said, amen. We ask that you now prepare for